story, I should probably tell you a little bit about Gunga. Gunga lived in a little Indian village. Gunga lived in a little village in India, and he was an orphan who was taken in by the missionaries who lived in that village, whom he called the Sahib and the Memsahib. The Sahib and the Memsahib had a little boy who was called Arthur, and they had a couple maids and servants, and among them was Bilji, Arthur's nurse. Well, today the compound was fairly empty because that morning the villagers had come asking the Sahib to go with them on a tiger hunt. Gunga had begged to go along, but they had said, "I'm sorry, you're too little." And so he was left at home with all the women and children and the old men, and he wasn't too thrilled about that. And so Gunga was sitting there on the steps of the house, not too thrilled, and just kind of moping there, and he got up and wandered down the path, and a voice startled him and said, "Gunga, why are you so sad?" He looked up, and there was the gardener weeding the flower beds. "Oh, yeah, they won't let me go on the tiger hunt," he said, "and it's kind of boring here." "Well, why don't you go play with little Arthur?" "Well, Nurse Bilji said he's going on a nap and I can't come back until he's ready to be up." "Oh," said the gardener. "Well, how about you go play your flute with the Memsahib?" For when he had come to the compound, the Memsahib had given him a flute and had taught him how to play some melodies. And Gunga really loved playing the flute. In fact, that was his favorite thing to do. But the Memsahib was sick with a headache, so he couldn't play with her either. "I know what you can do," said the gardener. "What? Tell me," said Gunga. "Why don't you go hunt the tiger with your flute?" "You are teasing me," said Gunga. "That's ridiculous." "Well, not completely," said the gardener, "because tigers' ears are very tender, and they do not like the high notes of a flute." "Oh," said Gunga. "Well, still not as interesting as a tiger hunt." So he kind of wandered away and tried to amuse himself with something that was, tried to think up something that could be in replacement of the tiger hunt, but he couldn't seem to get his mind off of it. That evening, he came to the house and he started to think about his flute again. That's when he got the bright idea to go practice with the Memsahib. Maybe she was, her headache had gone away. He quietly crept down the hallway and knocked at her door. Memsahib, are you there? Can you play the flute now?" No answer. There, down the hallway, was the open door to Baby Arthur's room. Maybe she isn't there, he thought. He quietly walked down, and as he stepped across the threshold, he froze. There in front of him on the veranda, in front of the open window, crouched a tiger, its tail slashing back and forth. Its vicious green eyes staring. He looked where he followed the eyes to where Baby Arthur was cooing in his mother's arms, her face drawn tight, and she, her lips were moving. He could tell she was crying. There at her feet lay crumpled in a heap lay Nurse Bilji, for she had fainted. Then all the courage that Gunga possessed welled up in him, and he jumped in between the tiger and the baby, yelling and waving his flute above his head. In a flash, he remembered what the gardener had said about the high notes of a flute. He began to play an Indian air. Then he quickly just kept playing, and the tiger rose up on his haunches and gave a loud roar, then took a step backwards. Gunga cautiously took a step forwards. The tiger slowly took another step back, its tail slashing back and forth in irritation at this unwanted obtruder. Slowly, slowly down the garden path they went, this strange procession. The tiger took a step backward, Gunga took a step forward, backward, forward, all the way down the dusty road through the village, towards the mango grove. Slowly, slowly, the tiger kept going backwards and Gunga forward. Then as they neared the mango grove, Gunga's voice began to get hot and sore, and he was kind of running out of breath and such, and he's like, if I don't stop playing, the tiger will eat me, but I cannot play much longer. He continued to play, though, for dear life at this point, until all of a sudden a shot rang out. The tiger leapt up into the air and let off an ear-splitting roar and then fell at his feet. Gunga crumpled up also because he was quite worn out after that. The next thing he knew, Mem Sahib and the Sahib and all the hunters were standing around him. When they saw he was awake, Mem Sahib said, "God must have sent you to save us at that precise moment. Only an angel could have prompted you to come." Then the hunters hoisted him to their shoulders and carried him through the village while the villagers cheered. From then on, Gunga was known as Gunga, the brave hunter. That evening at worship, the Sahib and the Mem Sahib and Gunga and all the other households read two very, very special promises, especially special to them after that day. Would anyone like to guess what they were? Any guesses? No? Okay, would someone like to read them?
The angel of the Lord encamps all around those who fear him and delivers them.
Amen.
Amen.
And the other one that they read was...
For he shall give his angels charge over you to keep you in all your ways. In their hands they shall bear you up, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the cobra, the young lion and the serpent you shall trample underfoot.
Amen.
Don't you think that was fitting about the lion?
Yeah.
They thought so, and this can be a... These promises can be special for us too. Would anyone like to pray?
Dear Jesus, thank you for your lessons in life. And thank you that we can have such a good story.
Amen. Amen.